God, I want to give you thanks for today. I want to give you thanks for your presence in our lives. I want to simply give you thanks and ask that you would now add the blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to open with one song, since as we talk about the coming of the Christ child, we have to talk about just the presence of our God. So, stand with me. Let's sing.
Church here, and as we said, we are going to get a wonderful chance to listen to some beautiful music by our choir today. But before we do that, I have just a couple of quick announcements for you. If you can't believe it, Christmas is in a week. So Christmas Eve services are obviously on Christmas Eve. They're going to be at 2:30, 4, and 5:30 p.m. And then what you really need to know is that next Sunday, Christmas Day, we will have one Christmas service. It will be at 9:30. It's our cozy Christmas service, so come wearing festive sweaters or your best Christmas-themed or winter-themed PJs. All of that is welcome, and we're going to enjoy a time of singing and fellowship together. And then the following week, New Year's Day, we will also only have one service at 9:30. However, Scott did say he'll be here early, so if you show up at the regular time, go ahead and grab a cup of coffee with Scott in the parlor.
Bring your coffee cup. I'm saving your place.
So again, Christmas Eve services, and then Christmas Day and New Year's Day only have one service at 9:30 each of those days. With that, I would like to hand it over to Larry and our choir. Thank you. Robert Herrick's poem written in the 17th century, still called to us today. What sweeter music can we bring than a carol for to sing, the birth of this, our heavenly King? We answer that call and make room in our hearts to celebrate the birth of the Christ child.
Just as we eagerly await the coming of spring after a cold and dark winter, the people of Israel yearn for the coming of the Messiah, the one whom the prophets foretold. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you.
troubled by his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her,
"Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever." Registered in the census with Mary, who was his betrothed. Mary was expecting a child.
While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no room in the inn. And there were shepherds living in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks by night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them,
"Do not be afraid. I bring good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.
Thank you.
company of angels appeared to shepherds in a nearby field, praising God and saying,
Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom God's favor rests.
When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us.
So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. After they saw him, the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen.
Thank you.
I would invite you at this time to take out the small hymnal in front of you, The Faith We Sing, and turn to number 2090 as we sing together the fourth verse for lighting the Advent candle. With us, all we need to do is keep our eyes open and look. Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. We light these candles, the candle of joyous hope, of proclaimed peace, of deep everlasting joy, and today of presence that speaks of love. As a sign that no matter our circumstance, we know we are not alone. Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him."
And the star they had seen went ahead of them to where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. They saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Joyful sounds of angels in the night sky,
to the worship by humble shepherds.
is so dramatic that it's almost unbelievable.
Yet we know it is true. Christ has come among us. He is among us right now, and our hearts long to worship him.
We are called to worship him with our whole lives. And as we do that, Christ is born again, forever changing us into his likeness.
Oh,
want to share scripture with you from the Old Testament, coming from the prophet Isaiah. And remember, there were at least two Isaiahs. The first Isaiah was bringing warning and saying, you people in Jerusalem, you're in such trouble. But second Isaiah picked up the pen right around this point, after Jerusalem had been destroyed and they had been carried into slavery. And this Isaiah now says this. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint nor grow weary. God's understanding is unsearchable. God gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And this, from the beginning of our Christmas story in Luke, the second chapter. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went down to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David.
Thank you, choir, for walking us through such a beautiful set of songs that brought us from the announcement of the coming of Christ up to the angelic proclamation of his birth. We witnessed the shepherds coming in and the magi traveling to see him. And now I want to take a step back. Over the last several weeks, we've been journeying to Christmas and looking at it through the eyes of Joseph. And I want us to take a moment to wrap up that journey today. This whole story has been filled with the unexpected. An unexpected baby conceived out of wedlock. Through an unexpected way, where Joseph was not the father. And this all led to a very unexpected plan that Mary and Joseph had not asked for, and yet graciously accepted, even if Joseph did require a little angelic intervention. But now it all culminates, and they have to embark on this unexpected and probably unwanted journey from Nazareth to Bethlehem. A census has been called, requiring them to go and register. There's no option to skip it. That could lead to punishments and fines, imprisonment, or even slavery. Yet we have to wonder why Joseph would take a very pregnant Mary on this 70-mile journey. We don't know exactly his reasonings. Perhaps he felt Mary would be safer with him than staying home. Censuses had been known to spark violent rebellions in the past. Perhaps keeping her with him was his way of ensuring her safety, and also keeping himself from worrying too much. Perhaps it was the prodding of the Holy Ghost. After all, the prophets had foretold that the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem. But for whatever reason, Joseph does take Mary, and off they go on what should be a 3-day journey. But if you have ever been pregnant or know someone who has been pregnant, there is nothing close to speed at the end of the pregnancy. You wobble everywhere. So it took them instead probably 9 days to 2 weeks. I don't think I would have wanted to be on that donkey for that long. Mary is large with child. She is exhausted, achy. She's probably having trouble sleeping. She's stressed, terrified over this unknown experience in front of her. She's probably not the best traveling partner right about now. This was not an easy journey. Perhaps this is often how we feel when we face unexpected journeys. They come about due to circumstances outside of our control. They may be difficult, painful, or even discouraging, and at times we might see them as punishment from God or a sign that God has abandoned us. But that is not God's way. When we find ourselves on these unexpected journeys, just like Mary and Joseph, it is important, it is vital that we remember God is there through it all. He is there to sustain us, walk with us, and lead us. And God can and will work through it, bringing good and beauty from even the toughest of journeys. I'm reminded of Jesus' own journey to the cross. It was not easy. It was terrifying. And the night before, we find Jesus praying in the Garden of Gethsemane, and even he asks, "Take this from me if you can." But he still says, "Not my will, but yours be done." In that moment of crisis and fear, Jesus turned to God, knowing God was there. I wonder if he learned that faith and trust from hearing Mary and Joseph tell the story of their own difficult journey all those years ago before he was born. I wonder if he took that and lived it in his own life. Yes, their journey was difficult, but Mary and Joseph's journey wasn't all bad. Yes, the census was called and forced them to go to Bethlehem, but Bethlehem is Joseph's hometown. He would have had family living there, and scattered relatives would be descending upon Bethlehem for the census as well. It's kind of the largest, noisiest family reunion you could probably ever imagine. We often read that there was no room in the inn. But the word originally used, cataluma, means guest room. Most likely, they went to a relative's house with all the other relatives. So, of course, it's filled to bursting. There's no extra space, certainly no space to privately have the birth of your child. And so we'll look at their getting placed in a stable as unfortunate, but really, I think we should look at it as a mark of compassion. Because instead of being in that noisy, crowded house where there would have been no space and no privacy, they are in a warm, quiet, clean space with all the privacy that they could want, time alone, and a space that is also very easily cleanable. This was compassion. This was a difficult journey that is not to be discounted, but God worked so much good from it. The Savior of the world came in the form of the weakest, lowliest, most humble person. And Jesus' ministry would then embody a life of humility and servanthood to the least, the last, and the lost. So I ask you to think about the journeys that you may be on right now. Are they ones you planned? Are they going exactly to plan? Probably not. But that's okay. Because God is still there. God is still working with you, working through you, and walking beside you, still able to work wonders in and through your life. God took what was truly a terrifying and dangerous journey for Mary and Joseph. God walked with them through it and used it to show God's love to the world through the most unexpected and unlikely of things. A child. A child who would grow to teach us all of God's unending love. A love that does not diminish when things get tough. A love that does not go away when we've picked the wrong path, then headstrong, reluctant, or even refuse. But a love that is there always and never lets go. God is with us on every journey, and God can use each and every journey if we would just keep quiet. And I encourage you to do just that. Keep walking. And along this path, you will find opportunities to reach out and take God's hand, and to reach out to those around you in the body of Christ, and to walk with them and have them walk with you. Let us keep walking all of these journeys together with God and each other. Amen. Would you please pray with me? Lord God, we don't always know what the path ahead will be, but we always know that you will be there with us through it all. Help us to remember that in all times you are there. Help us to feel your love even in the most difficult of circumstances. And help us be your hands, your feet, your eyes, your ears, and voice to those around us on their journeys as well. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We do not pass the plate, but if you would like to give a financial gift today, the joy baskets are outside in the lobby, outside the doors. But as I remind you each and every week, that is not your only gift. Your gift is you, your time, your talents, just you. And we thank you for that, and we ask for God's blessing on you. Would you please pray with me as we bless the offerings given today and also lift up our prayers and concerns to our Lord. Holy God, we thank you for this time together this morning, and we thank you for each and every person seated here, each and every person joining us online. We thank you for the gifts you have given to us, and we turn around and give part of that back to you. We ask your blessing on our gifts, that you would multiply them in service to your mission in the world, and that you would use us towards the new creation you are making. Lord, we lift up today as well the prayers of our hearts. Today we carry with us joys of birthdays, of anniversaries, of births, of growing families, of relatives descending for holidays, and we thank you for each and every joy that you have given. We also carry with us a lot of hurt and fears and concerns, and Lord, we lift those to you as well. We ask you to be with anyone who is hurting, all those who need healing. We ask for our neighbors who are lacking, that you would provide for them, provide through us. Lord, we lift up our community, and we lift up our world to you, and we ask your presence to be made known and to be felt. Work in us, walk with us, in all we do and everywhere we go. Pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. If you would please stand, we are going to sing together verse 1 of Christ Beside Me. You'll find it at number 2166 in the Faith We Sing.
You will recognize that the melody to this is Morning Has Broken. We're going to sing it twice.
Beside you, no matter what. Go in the love and peace of Christ. Amen.
Thank you. Early morning.